is a professor at the Paris School of Economics and also at the Toulouse School of Economics. He's also global professor at the New York University, Abu Dhabi. He has received the prestigious Yrjö Jansson Award in 2007, which is, by the way, the same award that was given to Thomas Piketty this year, or was it last year? He has written a number of books and articles, obviously. The list is too long to read out loud, but you should take a look at least his three latest books, which are Frictions and Institutions, which was published this year, The Tyranny of Utility, and Innovation and Inequality, How Does Technological Progress Affect Workers? So, without further ado, it's my great pleasure to welcome Professor Gilles Saint-Paul.
Thank you. So it's a pleasure for me to be here. It's always nice to come to Helsinki, despite the weather, but well, that's what we expect anyway. Okay, so I usually talk too much, and for this reason I prepared very few slides, and maybe I'm realizing that I will say too little this time. On the other hand, if it happens, this will leave more time for discussion. So actually, I'm going to do a little bit of science fiction here. What if technology can replace not only unskilled workers, but actually everybody? Think about the governor of a central bank. In macroeconomics classes, we teach that the central bank is supposed to follow a rule, for example, a rule that relates interest rates to inflation and the output gap. So basically, if monetary policy is about implementing such a rule, probably it's better to have this rule implemented by technology, by a robot, actually not even a robot, by a very simple computer software, than by the governor of the central bank. Then the central bank governors would tell you that it's very important to make announcements to markets and so forth, and hints and clues, and that it's a very delicate business. But of course, they are not credible because they are defending their own job. And in fact, Milton Friedman thought that the central bank was a completely useless institution. He was advocating for a rule that was, a different rule from the one we teach, but that was a very simple rule. And so you don't need a central bank. You just need, a printing press, and you need a computer to control the printing press. So that's an important question. I saw recently on YouTube a video of a rock concert in Japan. And one particularity is that the lead singer actually did not exist. The lead singer of the band was a hologram, was not a human. Okay? And that was very popular. I mean, it was thousands of people. There are many more people who go to these rock concerts than people who buy my books, for example. And so they love the hologram, So you can see that technology has reached such a critical point that you could ask a very general question, is human labor of any kind needed anymore? And then, what are the consequences of that? This is the question I am interested in. I think the consequences of that are analytically are a bit different from what we usually say when we think about things like a skill bias, technical change. Okay. Of course, if we look at the long run, we have reasons to be optimistic about technical change, even though technical change has always been protested by some people. Actually, since this is a left-wing audience, there are a couple of examples in the Marx's Capital about people who invented very impressive innovations in the textile industry, and they were condemned to death by the mayor of the city following protests. And so there are plenty of examples. The Luddites, of course, is a standard example, but even more recently, the 1970s, the dockers in harbors protested the introduction of containers. And of course, containers, I mean, it's easy to speculate that at least a 5 percentage point of your and my living standards are due to containers, because they are a very important vector of globalization. So if you have an iPad or whatever, it's somewhat thanks to containers. But yet, this was violently protested when it was introduced. And so if you look at the people who are displaced by those innovations, they seem very unhappy, their life is going worse. But if you look at the long run, you see that living standards have increased considerably, actually, almost unbelievably so. And this is due to innovations like containers. When macroeconomists do growth accounting, they see that the key driving force of growth in the long run is technical progress. So basically what's going on is that when you have an innovation, it harms some workers, but everybody else wins from the innovation. One interesting example, for example, is the assembly line. Before the invention of the assembly line, there was a sort of, fledgling automobile industry with very skilled workers who were doing almost, if not the entire automobile, they were doing many parts. And so these workers were had high skilled, well, relatively high skills, and they were relatively highly paid. Now, when the automobile, when the assembly line was introduced, it destroyed the jobs of those people, because then, of course, you could do an automobile with workers who were very low skilled. Okay, and so indeed, these people lost their specific human capital. On the other hand, the assembly line made cars affordable for millions of consumers. And indeed now, when we talk about poor people in the US, the poverty threshold, in fact, all these poor people, they have cars, which was a big luxury only 100 years ago. And at the same time, of course, it's known that this assembly line raised the productivity of those unskilled workers, which allowed people like Henry Ford to pay high wages. And actually, there is a sort of mythology I don't know if it's popular in Finland, but in France there is a mythology that industry was about, exploitation of the lower classes. But in fact, when you read novels, you see that when people moved from agriculture to industry, I mean workers, their living standards were increasing a lot. And I know, for example, a novel where a young girl from a farm finds a job in a fish canning factory, and she has a fantastic life. She goes to the movies, and instead of working 60 hours a week on the farm, she works 45 hours a week, and so on and so forth. So these innovations not only were good for consumers, but were also good for the workers who were working in these new industries. What we observe also is that societies that discourage innovation in the long run fail. In the 1930s, everybody was very enthusiastic about the Soviet Union. In the 1930s, everybody was either a communist or a fascist. It was not very trendy to be a bourgeois democratic society. No young people was supporting democracy in those days. And that was in part because those economies, and in particular the Soviet Union, were doing very well economically. Whereas at the same time, the West, the democratic bourgeois West, was doing very poorly economically. And in fact, many people extrapolated those trends and they say, you know, someday the Soviet Union is going to take over. And yet, this did not happen. The Soviet Union collapsed, and the Soviet Union had miserable living standards. If you ever, well, I guess a number of you have gone to Berlin, and there is a fantastic museum called the Museum of the German Democratic Republic. Everybody should go to this museum. In this museum, you can enter into a Trabant, the famous Trabant, and you learn that it was a two-stroke engine, like our little Velo Solex in France. So in 1989. This was still running with a two-stroke engine, just like in 1945. And you could not get it repaired unless you provide the spare parts yourself. So I guess there was a black market for spare parts and so forth. Okay? So this is what happens when you stall innovation, when you prohibit innovation. You become a sort of funny object in a museum after 40 years. So why were those communist countries growing? Because they were accumulating capital at a very high pace. How do you accumulate capital? You accumulate capital by preventing people from consuming, basically. You put them on a subsistence wage, and all the surplus goes to accumulating capital, tractors, Trabants, and so forth. The problem with capital accumulation is that you run into the law of decreasing returns. And once you run into the law of decreasing returns, okay, you have plenty of Trabants, but they still run on a two-stroke engine. So you don't grow anymore. And then you get taken over by the people who do not have Trabants, but they have, Mercedeses, and on top of that, they have VCRs, and they have all sorts of stuff, iPod, iPhones, etc. So if, in other words, if we had listened to the Luddites and to the docker unions who opposed the containers, if we had taken seriously what these people say, we would be like the German Democratic Republic was. That is to say, the Chinese tourists would visit the museums of, economic failures in our countries. So now we are observing, of course, that innovation continues, and we might ask the question, okay, it's going to harm some people, but everybody else is going to benefit. And, given that it's each wave of innovation does not harm the same people, containers do not harm automobile workers, and the assembly line does not harm dockers. So, when you are hit, you lose, but on average, everybody wins. Okay, so do we expect this to continue? Okay. Well, as was brilliantly made in the preceding presentation, we see that it's known that there is an upward trend in inequality over the recent decades. Now, as such, inequality need not be a problem. If I get rich by 10% and somebody who is richer than me gets rich by 50%, I still get rich by 10%. And I'm better off than, if both of us were only getting rich by 2%. So you care about your actual income, not about the income of other people. However, it's more than that. If you look at in many countries, the median wage is stagnating, and wages at the bottom of the distribution of wages, it's not that they are growing less fast than at the top, it's that they are actually falling. Okay? So it's a worrying trend. It's really that growth is benefiting, it looks like growth is only benefiting a minority. Well, then, a lot has been said about the role of information and communication technologies. First, because it's skill bias. You need to be skilled to know how to use a computer, although we could open that debate, but I won't do it here. And second, perhaps more importantly, information and communication technologies favors the superstars. So if you are just, you know, 1% more productive than somebody else who do the same thing as you do, then you have the whole market, because you can spread your talent over the whole over the whole economy. So that's an important mechanism. Well, personally, I tend to be optimistic about those things, because at the end of the day, you could think that. Well, first, as consumers, even though, you know, their wage measured by some CPI index in real terms tends to fall, if you take into account things like product variety that goes up due to innovation, then workers can benefit from that. They have iPods, iPads, computers, and tablets, and so forth. Then you may think, you know, going back to my central banker experience, that ICTs will eventually hit the skilled, so they will be, you know, unskilled biased, because at the end of the day, many skilled people can also be replaced by computers, and that's good for equality in some sense. It makes the relative wage of the unskilled go up again. Then the unskilled also have, you know, complementary capital inputs that whose productivity can be improved by technology. If you drive a crane, for example, you know, if the crane is intelligent, I don't know what that means, but you know, then your productivity as a driver of a crane goes up, right? So that's, that makes you more valuable, and it increases your wages. Okay. And then also, finally, I guess that was a big element of what we saw in the preceding presentation, the unskilled themselves will become more skilled. Everybody knows how to read, how to write, which was not the case 150 years ago. People are becoming more computer literate. And it's also known that people are becoming more intelligent. It's called the Flynn effect. You know, every cohort has a higher IQ than the preceding cohort, maybe because of, you know, selection or because of nutrition, whatever. So this is, if you want, the optimistic view. Well, here I wanted to put the picture of a robot, but my cohort is such that I could not download. I mean, it was there. Tried to click on the picture and download it, but it did not work out. So I let you speculate on this empty slide. Okay, now what if technology, instead of being biased, complementary, blah, 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 just replaces people, you know? Central bankers, rock stars, and everybody is going to be replaceable by a robot. How does such an economy look like? This is the question I want to ask. Well, basically, you can write down a growth model where you can invest in capital, but you can also invest in robots. Okay? Well, then, robots will be built as long as the annuity cost of a robot is lower than the wage, because then it's a good investment. And therefore, if robots are available, then the availability of robots will always drive wages down to the rental price of a robot. Okay, so this is, if you want, the key observation. So what does this mean? Well, it means that wages are tied to the production cost of robots. The cheaper the cost of a robot, the lower the rental price of a robot, and therefore the lower the rental price of a robot, the lower the wage. So if robots are less costly to make, you know, wages fall. Then, interestingly, this creates a tight link between wages and the cost of capital. And this changes the logic completely. Because in the past, in the standard neoclassical growth regime, if you want, if you have more capital, you have higher wages, because workers are more productive when there is more capital. But in the robot world, when capital is more abundant, when people save more, then this reduces the cost of capital, reduces interest rates, if you want, which also makes robots cheaper to produce, because robots are a form of capital. And therefore, this will not increase wages, it will actually reduce wages. So in the pre-robot world, more savings tend to be good for workers because it raises wages. But in the post-robot world, more savings is bad for workers because it reduces wages. You want capital to be scarce because you want robots to be scarce. Well, then, in the robot world, you no longer need to innovate. Because instead of innovating, you could accumulate more and more robots. In the pre-robot world, innovation is the only way to get out of the decreasing of the law of decreasing returns. Okay. So in some sense, in the pre-robot world, the Soviet Union was a failure. But in the post-robot world, accumulating robots is just like having more population, if you want. So GDP, you still have a law of decreasing returns in the sense that GDP per robot does not go up, but GDP per humans can go up indefinitely by just accumulating robots. Okay? So in some sense, a new Soviet Union that would accumulate robots instead of tractors would grow indefinitely in the post-robot world. However, presumably, one fear is that in a capitalist economy, the proceeds of this growth are not going to be equally shared. My presumption is that in the long run, some workers lose, but because it raises productivity for most people, when you have technical change, the wages of everybody grow proportionally. So you have more living standards for everybody. But here, wages do not grow. That's the problem. So growth is appropriated by those who own the robots, basically, by the capitalists. And workers, the only way workers can be better off is by saving themselves, by becoming capitalists themselves and by accumulating their own robots. Okay, the technical change per se does not benefit any worker. So basically, as this growth regime proceeds in the long run, you have a society where humans play a vanishing economic role. And so, in particular, the wage bill becomes a negligible share of GDP over time. It's a society where humans are rentiers. Your status in society depends on how many robots you control, basically. And that's it. So this, in my view, has important consequences, in particular for the educational system. I suppose, if you're a social democrat, you believe in education because it redistributes in favor of poorer people, and in some sense, it redistributes in a way that makes them autonomous. Okay, instead of giving you money, I give you education. Instead of giving you fish, I learn you how to catch fish. Okay, and so that's a nice ideal. And then these poor people, they have more human capital, which makes them more productive. They have higher wages and living standards. Okay. The problem is that in the robot world, the wage of human capital becomes very low. In the robot world, there would not be a Mario Draghi. There would be, a computer software instead of Mario Draghi that would implement the monetary policy rule. How much does such a computer software cost? I mean, zero, basically. The wage of Mario Draghi would be zero in the robot world. I mean, when you buy any video game for 10 euros, This is a much more complex software, orders of magnitude more complex than the monetary policy rule of the Eurozone. Okay? So even Mario Draghi would essentially earn zero. So what's the point of having a PhD in economics if you earn zero? If you have a PhD in economics, you are, say, 10 times more productive than if you are an unskilled worker, but 10 times zero is also equal to zero. There's no point in investing in education if the wage of human capital is zero. Okay? And so investment in human capital becomes wasteful. The Social Democratic Party disappears. Instead, you have the party of robots. And so, of course, what do you need to do in such a society to, counter the increase in inequality? Instead of giving education to the people, you have to give them robots. That's the only thing you can do. So basically, you end up with something which replicates the ancient slave owner societies, okay? Except that the slaves will be non-human, they will be robots. And then the citizens, just like the citizens in ancient Greece or ancient Rome, they will live off the labor of slaves. And they will, a citizen is somebody who owns slaves. And so you could think, to design such a society in a social democratic way, you need to, at the end of the day, you need to decide how many robots people are given on birth. Each human being is entitled to a certain number of robots, subsistence level of robots, dignity level of robots, whatever. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much. Once again, we have time for one question at this point and more after the comments. So we can take one question from the audience. Something about party of robots, perhaps?
I think. Thank you for your excellent and inspiring presentation. Just to build on a little bit on the concept of society based on robots, in a way it's already here. When you look at, for example, the energy sector, every single human being, at least in the industrialized countries, have about 150 people or slaves working for them every day and night. And I think it is just an inevitability that it will spread to other sorts of spheres of life. But I think it's a very interesting concept of seeing future generations living off in a Greek city-state type of society. I just wanted to comment on that. Thanks. Thank
you. Well, except that you still have 1.3 billion people in India who live in a robotic wage in some sense. So the size of human population is a little bit problematic for this, actually. Because in many countries, in a number of countries, it's actually cheaper to recruit somebody from the Indian subcontinent than having a robot.
All right, we will return with more questions in a couple of minutes. So thank you so much, Gilles Saint-Paul.